Hello learners, hi, how are you all doing? I hope you're all doing fantastic. I've recently concluded my batch for December 2022 examination and the batch has gone amazingly well. So before I celebrate way too much, I am here with some news for the new batch for May 2023 examination. So we have with us the May 2023 batch from the team of Fishers Academy on the platform of Unacademy. This is going to be an exclusive English comprehensive batch on the Unacademy platform brought to you exclusively by the team of Yashas Academy. This is for May or June 2023 attempt like I mentioned, and the batch is just started on 10th of November, just started. So you can definitely enroll to this batch. The reasons why you should enroll to this batch is you get to learn from the team of Fishers Academy. I will be handling your accounting paper, Principles and Practice of Accounting. I am C.E. Rajwardhan. And you will get to learn Mathematics, Statics and Statistics and Logical Reasoning from Anil Mishra sir. You will be learning Economics and BCK from Shanda Ramat sir, Law from Nitika Bachawat madam, and BCR from Pooja Jatwani ma'am. You know the advantages of Unacademy's plus subscription and the features of the batch. Live interactive classes, very much in-depth and comprehensive. There would be regular revision and practice sessions. We're going to do a lot of quizzes, a lot of mock paper revisions, RTP revisions, exam paper discussion to ensure that you are very well equipped for the examination. The structured course PDFs will be shared to you people to read from. Unlimited access to recorded classes will be available throughout the subscription period. And as I mentioned, live tests and quizzes will take the level of preparation to another level. Then, the schedule of the batch is this way. This is going to be an evening batch wherein our sessions will start at 3 p.m. in the evening. The first session will be 3 to 5:30 with an half an hour break till 6 p.m. and the second session is from 6 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Starting on 10th of November is classes from Anil sir, who will take up your math, stats and logical reasoning. A little later in the month, 21st of November, you will see Nitika ma'am teaching you law, and 29th, Shan sir will be starting your economics part. And I will be starting accounts on December 7th. We'll be eagerly waiting to start the accounts and then teach it to all of you people. We're going to start it from way basic, what is expense, asset, liability, income. We're going to go as complex as how to deal with calls in advance, arrears, pro rata, allotment, along with forfeiture, reissue of equity shares and also debentures. That's your chapter 10. So 1 to 10, A to Z, everything will be comprehensively covered in this course. You don't have to look into any other classes if you enroll for this batch, and the success is definitely assured. The features of plus subscription on the Unacademy platform is you get live interactive classes, the structured course PDF will be shared to you, live tests and quizzes will be there, open house will be conducted at regular intervals where you can interact, communicate and talk with your fellow learners as well as the faculty to take help in exam preparations. Digital notes is shared so that we save a lot of paper. An academy community is also there where you can interact with fellow learners. And all of these features will be accessible to you for an unlimited amount of usage within the subscription period. You can also choose to take iconic subscription, which is all the plus benefits. Plus, you also get one-to-one live mentorship throughout your preparation. You get printed study material at your doorstep. And also doubt solving sessions will be arranged to leave no stone unturned. What are you waiting for? Take up an Academy subscription today, and the cost of subscription is about 1063 per month for 24 months, 1250 per month for 18 months, 1567 per month for 12 months. If you choose to take up iconic subscription, you would have to pay 1829 per month for 24 months, 2139 for 18 months, and 2625 for 12 months. And if in case you use the code YASHAS, which is YASHAS, you get 10% flat off on the price that you just saw on the screen. So what are you waiting for? Take up an Academy subscription today and join us in this journey of CA Foundation. We promise to take you ahead across the CA Foundation journey into CA Intermediate Examination level. Hoping to see you all in the class. And now let's get started with the topic of the hour. In this video, we'll be discussing a topic from your chapter 6 special transactions. It is chapter 6.2, sale of goods on return on accrual basis. One such topic which is a easy cake in the examination. If in case the question comes from this examination for 5 marks or 6 marks or 8 marks, you can crack it like nothing. Like if you get in a question, no, you don't just solve the question. First you say yes and then you solve the question. So that's how this chapter is going to be. So why waste time? Let's get started. The topic is sale of goods on return or approval basis. So there is this one guy who wants to sell the goods. And he doesn't sell the goods, but he sends the goods to the user. Because the user is not much aware of the product. The user is not familiar with the brand. The user has a lot of questions. So our first person sends the goods. The sender sends the goods to the user asking, you keep it with you. If in case you can sell it to somebody, or if in case you feel like using it, you accept it and pay me money. If not, you return the goods back to me. Do you get it? So this is not a sale at all at the first place. So to the guy who's sending it, remember that he is sending the goods and is not selling the goods. The goods here are sent and not sold. Secondly, with regard to the person on the other side, he is receiving the goods. He is receiving the goods. Goods are received but not purchased. And because the goods are only sent and not sold, the ownership is still retained with the sender and ownership is not with the recipient. Recipient of the goods has only possession of the goods. Chalo, let's see that. The sender of the goods only has the, sender of the goods has the ownership, but it doesn't have the possession. However, the one who has received the goods now has the possession of the goods only, but it doesn't have the ownership. You get it? So the goods are sent by the sender to the receiver, not sold. The ownership is still with the sender. The possession is with the buyer. Not the buyer, but the receiver. Got it? Now, should the person who sent the goods record it as sales in his books? Is the golden question. What do you think is the answer? The person who is sending the goods should not record it as sales. The answer is no. It cannot be recorded as sales because the goods are only sent. Goods are not sold. Goods are only sent and not sold. But why is it so? It is only sent and not sold. Goods are given to him now. Can't we say the transfer of possession as transfer of ownership? The answer is no, because the person who received the goods is not the buyer. He has an option to either accept the goods, that is approve the receipt of the goods and then keep it with him, or he has also an option of declining the goods, denying the receipt of goods, returning it back, saying you keep your goods boss, I don't want your goods. He can either accept it or return it. Very good. But the time period will be specified by the person who's sending the goods, saying you can accept it or return it within a specified time. If you don't react till a specific period of time, I would call it sold, guys. I would call it sold. Meaning, if I am the sender, I give the goods to receiver and then say, boss, I am not selling it to you, I am sending it to you. You keep the goods with you. If you want, you say yes, I'll write it as sale. If not, you can return the goods to me. What if it takes 6 months time but still doesn't say yes? I am under a little pressure now because neither have I received the money nor have I accomplished the fact that I will receive it, because he can return the goods at any point of time. So I have given him a time frame saying that, boss, 3 months is the time. Within 3 months, either tell me a good news that you have accepted the goods, or I'll assume that you have accepted it and I will not accept any returns after 3 months. I can tell that. So what is it? I have given him the time frame of 3 months. If he has to return the goods, he has to return within 3 months. If it doesn't return the goods within 3 months, it is assumed to be sold. Got that? Yes. So the next point is, there will be a time frame. If the time to return has lapsed, then it is assumed to be accepted. There is no option. There is no right to return the goods. I hope you have established this fact. And this is what makes the case of accounting interesting in the books of sender. In this chapter or in this unit, the entire accounting is seen from the perspective of the sender. We represent sender for accounting. We do entire accounting in the books of sender's books exclusively. Come on. So when to record sales entry? Should we record sales entry when the goods are sent? should record sales enter when the goods are accepted by him. Have a look. Under two circumstances, we record the sale entry. Number one, when he says yes. Sir, if he doesn't say yes, if he doesn't accept or approve, how can you say two circumstances? What is the second circumstance? Pretty simple. He says no and he returns the goods. What if I will not accept the return because he didn't return in time? Then he has no option but to accept. Yes. The two circumstances where it would be regarded as sale is, number one, when he has accepted it or approved. Number two, when his right to return has lapsed, meaning the time period that is allowed to him for him to return the goods has lapsed. Time to return has lapsed. These are the two circumstances where it is sale to the sender. Till then, it is only goods sent and not sold. I hope you copied. Let me quickly reply. The sender of the goods has the ownership and has only transferred the possession. Recipient of the goods has only possession but not ownership. The recipient of the goods has option to either retain or return the goods. However, it is specifically restricted for a prime period of time. At the end of such time period, he has no option to return the goods but to accept it. So, the sender of the goods should record it as sale when the recipient accepts or approves the sale or when the recipient's time to return is lapsed. I hope you all got this. Then, going forward, let us now see how the accounting should be done for sale of goods on return or approval basis. How exactly should the accounting be done? This depends upon the quantum of the transaction involved in a year with regard to goods on return or approval. Me being a sender, how often am I sending goods on return or approval basis is the determinant factor which will make me choose the accounting process. If I am doing very few transactions, rarely, one here and there, one in Amavasya, one in Unime. Get what? Once in a blue moon is what I am doing these transactions. Very few transactions. Then I record it as normal sale transaction. I can go ahead and record it as normal sale transaction. If the transactions are little frequent, then I will go down to prepare a multi-column journal. You get it? Or if the transactions are too many, what is it? Too many or numerous transactions, then I will maintain a separate day book for sale or return basis. Separate day book. That's how the accounting needs to be done. Let's see. When the transactions are very few, what do you do? Prepare, treat them as ordinary sale. And then when the transactions are too frequent, then what do? We'll prepare sale or return journal. When there are numerous transactions, boss, I prepare a day book or ledger. I hope you all got this. Let's see how to treat it as ordinary sale in detail now. Now, as a sender, I can be either a very optimistic person or I can be a very pessimistic person. How do you define optimist and pessimist? You might have read this story online quite a lot of times. If someone shows you a bottle of water, then ask, what is it? If you say half full, you're optimist. If you say half empty, you are pessimist. I would say be realist. Say it is 60% full. And people, they say some people are, opportunist. They say the bottle is 60% full and I feel my responsibility in filling the other 40%. I have a question. How the hell does a human fill the 40% of the bottle? Gee, come on, keep that things aside. Let's get back into business. So the sender here can be optimist or a pessimist. If he is optimist, he believes that the recipient of the goods will surely accept it. And he doesn't wait for the acceptance. Even before that, he'll write the sale letter. It is like this. You go to a girl. You see her beautiful. You love her. You see your life with her. So take a rose, propose to her, and then give her a day's time to say yes or no. And before she gets back, you book one chowdhury and then come back. And on the way, you book catering also. Why? Confident, very optimistic. If the sender of the goods is so optimistic in life, what would he do? He would not wait for the girl to accept. Sorry. He would not wait the recipient to accept it as goods purchase. He will write the sale entry when the goods are sent. Let me say, he would write the sale entry when the goods are sent, not when the goods are accepted by him. Then there is a pessimistic fellow who will accept, who will record the entry only when the other person accepts. We'll discuss that little later. So the sale entry is passed at the time the goods are sent. So when the goods are sent, what is the entry that we would write? We would write the normal sale entry. I will not write cash to sales definitely because this is credit sales. I will write the party's name to sales, meaning basically trade receivables account debit to sales account. This is the entry that I'll pass when the goods are sent. Now, your intuition is saying, sir, but it is not sale, it is only sent. Yes, I know that it is not sold, it is only sent. But this guy is on optimistic. He also bought the catering. He also bought the wedding cell. Meanwhile, on the way, he also thought of the kid's name before he came back to hear yes from the girl. So if he's so optimistic, he wrote the sale entry when the goods are sent. Great. Let's go ahead. So once the goods are sent, there are two possibilities now. The person who received the goods can either accept it or deny it. If he accepts it, what is the entry? If he accepts it, then he won't write any entry at the same price. No entry. What is no entry? No entry is Salman Khan, Anil Kapoor, Bipasha Basu, Lara Dutta. So you don't have to write any separate entry. Why is it that you don't have to write any separate entry? Because you are so optimistic that when you send the goods only, already you wrote the sale entry. Now when the other person says yes, what separate entry will you write? Logical, right? However, you send the goods at 100 rupees. The other guy accepted. Now you are placing a condition that acceptance means 120 rupees. Boss, 100 rupees available. Possible? Very much yes. When you know that the other person is very much in need or the demand for your product is high, you can increase the price of the goods. So, you have previously written the sale entry as trade receivable to sales at 100 rupees. Now, if the sale is accepted by the other party, but you put a condition that sale has to be accepted at higher price and he does accept it. You have already written entry at 100, but he has accepted the goods at 110. Now you need to reiterate this entry to 110, which is actually not possible because the entry is already written. What do you do in such case? You will pass a separate entry for additional 10 rupees. As simple as that. You will pass a separate entry for the remaining 10 rupees. So you need to pass one more entry, trade receivable to sales, for the differential increase in price. This is when the acceptance is made at higher price. Similarly, you have sent the goods, you asked the person to accept it, you are optimistic and you wrote the sale entry for 100. Then comes that guy, he accepted the goods. Like, yes, but on a condition that he accepts it at 90 rupees. Oh, you already written 100. You thought you scored 100 and celebrated, but later you understood you are still at 90s. Nervous 90s. What do? You reverse your sale entry to the extent of 10 rupees. You reverse your sale entry to the extent of 10 rupees. So that this sale entry which was passed at 100 will now get reiterated to 90 rupees. Got that? So you write the entry sales account debit to trade receivable account for the decrease in the price. Let us see, if the same has been accepted or approved at lower price, then the entry will be sales account debit to trade receivable account. Oopsie doopsie, I'm sorry, this entry is wrong here. It should have been sales account debit to trade receivables account. Sorry, it should be sales account debit to trade receivables account. This is for decrease in price. I'm really sorry. This entry should have been sales to trade receivables. I'll change it in the later part of the presentation. Then, if in case it is declined or denied, what is the entry? Then you have already passed a sale entry which is incorrect. So you would have to reverse that sale entry. Sale entry previously passed is trade receivable to sales. Now you will reverse it to write it as sales account debit to trade receivables account. That is the entry that you need to pass when the goods which were sent were recorded as sale but later denied. Great. Now, let's come to an interesting scenario here. You have sent the goods with 1 month period to return. The date of sending is 15th of March. And 31st of March, neither has that guy told yes, nor has that guy told no. He has neither accepted it, nor has he returned the goods. But we are on 31st of March. On this date, we have to prepare our financial statements, for which we take the entire transactions into consideration, in which we have recorded this transaction already as sale. But is it sales? It's not sales. Do you have the ownership? Yes. Do you have the possession? So, right now we are in a jinx of movement where goods which were sent on return or approval basis have been neither accepted nor returned. And the time period for him to say yes or no has not yet lapsed. If it has lapsed, then you call it sale. But unfortunately, neither has he told yes nor has he told no, and he still has time to say yes or no. So, on this date, you have already wrongly recorded as sale, which needs to be reversed. And on this 31st of March, when you evaluate your inventory by counting the stock in the godown, you will not count that stock because that's not in your godown. You don't have the possession of it. But do you have the ownership? Yes. Should you include it in your closing stock? Yes. Will it affect your profit computation? Yes. Will it affect your financial position? Obviously, yes. But is it included in the inventory at your godown? No. So what should we do? We should include it separately in our inventory. You might have done similar adjustments in your valuation of inventory chapter. So remember, if the goods are neither accepted nor returned and the time to return has not lapsed, we need to remember two key points. One, we don't possess the goods but we own it. We have wrongly recorded as sale already. What do? You reverse the sale entry. The reversal of the sale entry is sales account debit to trade receivables account. Previously written trade receivable to sales, we will reverse that entry by writing the entry as trade receivables account, sales account debit to trade receivables account. Secondly, the inventory belongs to us and we need to record it. It should come in trading account credit side, so credit trading, and the debit will be stock with customer account. See, this entry will be stock with customer at trading account. Previously, we recorded sales entry at selling price, so the reversal of sales entry should happen at selling price. However, whenever we include it in our own stock, we need to write the entry at cost price because stock will be recorded in our books of accounts at cost price. There might be certain circumstances where you have access to net realizable value of the stock. You compare cost or NRV because para 5 or phase 2 requires you to do so. And when you do that, you will correct it simultaneously. But remember, reversal of the sales entry should be at selling price, but the recording of stock in the books of accounts entry should be at cost price. Great. This is the optimistic case. Now let us discuss a pessimistic case wherein we don't record the sale entry when the goods are sent. We are waiting. For the recipient to say yes. When the recipient says yes, that's when we'll record sales entry. Till then, we are not going to record sales entry. We will wait. You get that? So sales entry is not passed at the time of sending the goods. So when the goods are sent, we are not recording sales entry. Meaning, when the goods are sent, it is no entry, no entry, no entry, no entry. Salman Khan, Bipasha Basu, Lara Dutta, Anil Kapoor. We will not write any entry when the goods are sent. We will wait. Intasar kab tak hum karenge wala. Till when will you wait? Till the time the recipient of the goods says yes. So, one fine moment, the recipient of the goods has approved. Yes! He might approve it at the same price, higher price or lower price. We will write our simple trade receivables to trade receivables to sales entry at such price. Why? Previously, we used to write the entry at the time of sending the goods. So, if there was higher price, for such higher price, one more entry. If there is lower price, for such price, we need to reverse the entry. All that is not required. Why? When the goods are sent, we didn't write any entry. Whatever we record now is the entry. So record it at the correct price. Khatam. Got it? Second thing, if the goods are declined, then what do you do? At the time when the goods were sent, you didn't write any entry. So when they are declined also, you will not write any entry. So it's once again no entry. You get that? Nice. Here comes the interesting part. What if the goods were sent on return or approval basis? Goods have been neither accepted nor returned and time to return has not lapsed. What do you do in such a case? Goods have been neither accepted nor returned and the time has not lapsed. Remember, we have not passed sales entry in this case. In this case, we have not passed any sales entry. At the time when the goods are sent, we have written only, we have written no entry. We are waiting to write the entry only when we only when they accept the goods. So, we don't have to reverse any sales entry in this case. But, still the fact that ownership is with us and the subscription, ownership is with us and the possession is with other party still is true. So, we need to include such inventory in our closing stock But when we physically count the inventory, that is not there. So that reversal of sales entry, what you wrote in the optimistic case, let me show. Here you wrote that reversal of sales entry at selling price. This entry is not required. However, you still need to write the entry at cost price to include the stock. Yeah, come on, let's go ahead. We don't have to reverse the sale entry, but we can pass the entry to recognize the stock. For which the entry is stock with customer account debit to trading account. And this is at cost price. And as on the year end date, so far in the case where the goods are sent, neither accepted nor returned. Neither accepted nor returned. And the time to lapse is not over yet. What will happen in the next year? In the next year, after the year end, there are two possibilities. He can accept it. He can deny it. Correct? No? This is with regard to the goods which were sent in the previous year, which on the year end were neither accepted nor returned in the time period has not lapsed. It can either be accepted or denied. If it is accepted, we will write the fresh sale entry. Why? Irrespective whether you are optimistic or pessimistic. If you are optimistic, the sale entry was reversed. If you are pessimistic, sale entry was not passed. So in the next year, irrespective of what approach was passed in the previous year, now we need to pass a sale entry. We need to pass the sale entry fresh, that is trade receivable account debit to sales account. Because nenne nenne ke naale naale. Correct or not? So irrespective of the fact whether you are optimist or pessimist in the previous year, you need to write the entry for sale in the year of acceptance. Because if you were an optimist and you had recorded the sale entry, such a sale entry would have been reversed at the end of the year. If you are a pessimist, you had not written the sale entry when the goods were sent, you have to write it now because it is a sale now. And if the goods are returned or denied, we will write no entry. Salman Khan, Anil Kapoor, Bipasha, Basulara Datta. We don't have to write an entry. Why we don't have to write an entry? Pretty simple. See, if you are pessimist, if you are optimist and the goods were recorded as sale, it is however returned, however reversed. So now specifically when he returns the goods, it is as good as what happened on the year end, what we did. So no need of entry. And if you are pessimist, you didn't write the entry and you send the goods, you don't have to reverse the entry when they return the goods. As simple as that. Got that? Sale entry, if passed, should have been reversed on year end. Would have been reversed on year end. So you don't have to deal with this. This is the point to remember. And this is how you record when the transactions are very few. That is, treating the transaction as ordinary sale. I hope you guys understood this. This is what we discussed under the treatment as ordinary sale for sale of goods on return on approval basis. Now, let us discuss another case, that is when the transactions are little frequent, how do you deal with it? We prepare multi-column journal. What do we prepare? Remember the word? We are going to prepare a multi-column journal. It's a journal book with multiple columns. As you can see, there are four parts in this multi-column journal. Part 1, Part 2, Part 3 and Part 4. Part 1 will write goods sent on return or approval basis will be recorded here. We write the date of the transaction. We write the particulars, the person to whom you sent and the amount. After you write this goods sent, you will write the next column wherein you write the goods accepted. If such a party accepts the goods, we'll write the date on which he accepts, the party who has accepted and the amount. Or if at the end of the period, he doesn't say yes, still it is accepted, we write it at the end of the period date and write the name of the party and write amount. That is if the goods are returned. Similarly, if the goods are approved and if the goods are neither returned nor approved within the time period, within the end of the year. And at the end of the year, when we are preparing this multi-column journal, the time to return is still not lapsed, we would write it in the balance column here. So the transactions that appears in the first column, goods sent on approval, should either appear on goods returned column or approved column. If it is neither returned nor approved, but the time has lapsed, it is still approved. If the time has not lapsed at the end of the year, then we will write in the balance column. This will be adjusted in the next period. And the three columns within each of it is date, particulars and amount. You can also put in a ledger folio column there, but I've removed it. So each case may date particular amounts, date particular amounts. You would not write date particular amounts in balance column. Just corresponding to the transaction, you'll write the amount in balance column. We will be doing a lot of problems on this in the next video. So you can watch the next video, the next part in the same YouTube channel where you're watching this. And I've also put in a lot of other topics, consignment master problem, final accounts master problem, then how to say, quite a lot of for valuation of inventories master problem, BRS master problem is there, marathon revision for CA foundation examination is there, question paper analysis video is there, RTP is there, MTP is there, quite a lot of videos are there in the same channel which you can definitely go back to and then watch. If you want, search for the name CA Rajwardhan or Accounts Man, you will find me on the social media wherever you are watching this video. Get it? So then we have the last case, sale or return demo. This is done when the transactions are numerous, way too many. Then what do? We prepare a separate day book, like a sales book, subsidiary book, and then we also prepare a ledger. And I'm going to show the ledger. Very simple. Like any other ledger, you will have debit and credit. When the goods are sold or when the goods are sent on return or approval basis, we'll write on the credit side the name of the parties. And this will basically have date particulars and amount column, like any other ledger does. Date particulars amount, date particulars amount. On the credit side, you'll write the names of the parties, by sundries, goods sent on return or approval. If you have sent goods to Amal, Bimal and Chand, you'll write Amal, goods sent, Bimal, how much sent, Chand, each whatever is sent. You'll write the names of the parties with the amounts in the subsequent column. If these goods have been accepted, it would come on the debit side to sundries, that is sales. If it is returned, it would again come on the debit side to be returned. If the goods are sent, which is appearing on the credit, has neither been accepted nor returned, then it would appear as a balance on the debit side. Goods which are neither sold nor returned. And that would be the end of this ledger. You can also get questions on this topic in the examination. So we will be solving it in the future. And this is the overall revision of the topic of sale of goods on return or approval basis. In this video, we saw the overall theoretical understanding of the chapter one shot in the quick bulletin time without losing any part of it, everything in such small phase of time. And in the next video, we'll be solving about 10 questions, 11 questions from this very chapter, covering head to toe of your ICA material as well as past examination and RTP questions. So stay tuned to watch that. Till then, remember, life is not a battle to be struggling, it's a game to be enjoyed. Till the time you're learning something, you're having fun, it's all good. The day you guys either stop learning something new or stop having fun, trust me, you might start struggling because you might be in a battle. So the thumb rule to stay happy is pretty simple. It is to stay in the game. So for one last time on this day, I have just one simple question for all of you. Are we in the game? I hope the answer is yes, we are in the game. See you all in the next one. Till then, ta-ta, bye, take care and get